And Professor Prati with the official Honorary Doctorate of Arts Diploma. Thank you, Dr. Bunwak.
Authorities, professors, and students, I am very honored to be doctor of Stanford University, and I understand how important it is for me to be linked to a community that is spread over all the world, that is really shaping a new generation with a new, completely new mentality. And it's quite interesting to link it to Bridge that has the same aim of putting people together. So from one side, a new generation that will shape the future world. From the other side, an association of Nobel Prizes that they have already changed the shape of the world, and they are sticking together in order to do it in an orderly way. And I am so honored to be in this top environment. And my short speech of today, I say short because I know that the most important part in the university is question and answer, is talking together, will be how to work for peace in an environment that is changing so quickly. That to be short in one sentence, going from monopolar to the multipolar world in which the problem is not anymore, let's say, how to handle a Cold War, but how to meet, to make people and nations meeting together. And, you know, this is really a fantastic achievement that we have to get, and this is a challenge that is the most important challenge that mankind has in front of it. And I shall try to bring also one bit of my European experience, in which we tried really to forget centuries of history of wars and tragedies, and try with a let's say, the humble job of creating a new international environment in which peace could prevail. This is a very short, let's say, summary of my short speech. Well, first of all, let us start from the past. Everybody must understand and know that 18th and 19th centuries were the centuries of Europe, the 20th century being the century of United States, and everybody of us was ready to think 20 years ago that even the 21st century should have been the center of United States. But in this period, the world is changing much faster, much quicker than everybody of us have never imagined in the past. And even in the common language, the 21st century is called already the century of Asia, with the change that is happening so quick in this moment. And the reason for that are political and economic. The economic reason is very simple. The change is beyond any forecast. few figures. In the 50s, in the 1950s, United States, they had from 45 to 50% of world GDP, and United States plus Canada and Europe, even if Europe came out of a terrible war, they had 68% of world GDP. It's 60 years ago, not long time ago, from 55, 60 years ago. And in the meantime, this will link our arguing to a second aspect, the political aspect. In the meantime, the United States was supporting the same shares of the military cost, of the military burden of the war, from 45 to 50% of the military expenditure. And, you know, this is why, even 20 years ago, a famous historian was talking about the end of history, because it was such a monopolar world in which there was no room for change in history. And now the situation is different. United States have around still very prominent and strong and affluent country of the world, but only 20-21% of world GDP. Europe the same, a little more or a little less, depending upon the rate of exchange of the euro and the dollar. And, you know, so altogether they are 40% of world GDP, and the Asian share is increasing, and even more because of the rate of growth. It's the balance will come much earlier than before. Probably in 10 years' time, the absolute GDP of China will be equal to the American one. This does not mean equal per capita, of course, you know, but in terms of national income will be the same. And this is an incredible, fantastic change in world history. This does not mean that even the military power changed with the same speed, because if you analyze the military expenditure, you find that today United States, they spend a share that is not so different from the share they were affording in the 50s or the 60s. The military spending in the United States is around 40-45% of world expenditure. And this is also the key of an imbalance. The United States, by far, and will remain for a long time, by far the most powerful country in the world, but the burden of this role is becoming day by day stronger and difficult to get. Let's say United States, the most powerful country in the world, but cannot exercise this power alone because of the changing of the economic environment. So we are going, in this sense, we are going in the direction of a clearly multipolar world. And clearly this brings us to the fact that it's all the burden that you have in the American budget, all the problems that you read now on the future austerity or necessity of changing the budget, they are in substantial part the consequence of an internal increase of expenditure, but also of this strong international burden that is still on the shoulders of the United States, and the imbalance between the economic share and the military share of the world. And this is the first characteristic, you know. And the Asian growth is so important that you can sum up in one picture, the picture of this year, not to be too academic, you know, but this year you will have a Asian growth starting from China that is the highest in the world. China is between 7.5-8%. Asian can be a couple of points less as average, but all the continent is growing. You have United States 2% and Europe 0. And this gives you how different is the movement in this period, you know. And look, not only this, let's say, quantitative change, but a second phenomenon, it was very important in the recent years, the financial crisis. The financial crisis in the United States has been at least partially overpassed, you know, it's step by step the country is getting out, but it's still hitting Europe and is giving an additional contribution to the change in the relative power in the world. And this is even more important, this has given a question mark to the certainty of the market system. Market economy is still the foundation of our economy. Even the former communist countries, if when they have chosen the market economy, they have started to grow. This is the foundation of the modern society, but if not well run, if not well controlled, this can give imbalances toward the economy that will heavily damage the rate of growth of the most advanced economy. And this is, of course, now is given for granted, but if you read a lot of economic textbooks 20 years ago or 10 years ago, they were writing, the most part of them, they were writing that the big crises were over, that because of International Monetary Fund, because of Keynes theory, because of cooperation. This was a problem of the past. Economic cycles were thought to be a problem of the past. And this is another issue that have changed heavily the reality. Clearly, there was also, as I told before, some political mistake. I do think that the beginning of the military of the political change is the war in Iraq, the Iraqi war, in which the Iraqi war was supposed to be the seal of the American power, and has been transformed in the beginning of the change, because instead of being a few weeks war, it was long without substantial results, putting in an uneasy situation all the Middle East, and so giving an additional contribution to the change of the political reality. Of course, linked to this, we have the Afghanistan war, and it was not only a military problem, but it was a deep political change, because the Iraqi war was for quite a few years the beginning of a split, of a division between European states, between European nations, that has had a lot of influence in our history. You had from one side United Kingdom, Spain and Italy, from the other side France and Germany, one with a completely different foreign policy. And this is been a contribution to the division of the Western world, and the last important change in the last generation, it is a change that is equally negative for the old countries and the new countries. And I put this in the end because it's not a contribution to the split, but is a question mark to the peaceful development of the world. That is a general increase in inequality in the world. It's something that has been underestimated in the link with the financial crisis, but that we cannot underestimate. First of all, facts. Inequality has increased everywhere in the world. China, United States, Europe, except very few cases, the Scandinavian countries, and the last 10 years, Brazil. But in all other countries, we have an enormous increase in inequality. And this is bringing a problem to growth, because clearly the distribution from the high consumption population to the low consumption high saving population of income, it is a burden to the development, and it becomes difficult in the contemporary society. It is a contradiction to think, as many think, that let's say wage and salaries must decrease and have a cost competition, but the purchasing power of population must, and people must buy more. It's a contradiction to think that the general population can buy more and give push to the growth, and at the same time being paid less. You know, it's not sustainable. So I repeat, this is different from the problem I mentioned before, because it's common to all the society, but is a clear message of instability for the future world society. In this situation, clearly, we need a new settlement of the world. We should need a strong cooperation, a stronger cooperation. We should need bridges. And in the political problem of humanity, we should need stronger and stronger United Nations International Association. And this is not the case. And I tell you frankly that in the moment of change, it's very difficult to agree on common rules. Not only in political problems, and then you have the split on the Syrian case, on the Libyan case, not only on Iraq, you know, but you have still different interests. But even in the economic reform that we need, take the example of the monetary system. We should need a complete reform of the monetary system that must adapt itself to the new economic reality that I described before. And before any G8 in the past or any G20 meeting now, you read the papers and everybody will tell you this will be the moment of the big reform of the international system. It never happens. And in my opinion, it will not happen for a substantial period of time. Why? Because it's very simple. You know, United States has no interest to reform, because now it's the privilege of the dollar is strong in the world, and China has no interest to reform, because any reform that will be done later will be better for China. And so, I repeat, the moment of change are not the moment for an agreement. And so you will not be surprised. In this have to tell a small parenthesis in this. I never mentioned Europe, you know, in this first part of the speech. And it can be surprising for you, for a former president of the European Commission, so passionate about Europe, but I want to introduce it now. In this situation, it's clear that you are not surprised that even Europe is in a very difficult moment, because even Europe is suffering the change of the political and economic situation I have described before. But clearly, I think that the most important contribution to world solidarity to prepare the idea of how the world must be in the future has been given by Europe. Till 60 years ago, Europe have never seen one generation in peace. Since the Roman Empire, I don't talk about the last years, you know. We always had wars. Our young generation were always regularly dying in war, and already 60 years we are in peace. We are trying to build common institutions. We have problems at the euro now, but they are problems given by, as a consequence of a positive, clear idea of trying to build something together that will go beyond national states, you know. And we started with 6 countries. Now we are 27 countries in the Union, and 27 countries with almost 500 million people. For last census, is 496 million Europeans together. And clearly, this change cannot be done without difficulties, without problems, without tension, without, let's say, the permanence of the old nationalistic ideas, you know, because it's we are changing the nature of the nations, you know, and this cannot be something that can be done in one day. And so I think that in this difficult change of history, the European teaching is so important. You know, I'm always thinking on the tension that you have in Asia. You know, if you think to Japan, China in this moment or other. But you know, do you really think that the relation between France and Germany were better? But there is a moment in history in which clearly you have to tackle the problem, to try to understand, to change it. And in Asia, there is a great positive aspect. In spite of all the tension that Asia has, the economic links are increasing. If you look at trade, even trade among the countries that now have this dispute for islands, you know, blah, 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 blah. Trades, crossing investments, cooperation, they're increasing day by day. And this is the direction in which we have to exploit and to build our, exploit for the good, the political behavior, and build a better future. We can do it. I think that, of course, you need imagination, you need good faith, you need time and patience. But the today situation in Europe, and I am speaking of today, the worst year for European history in economic aspect of it, you know. But even taking account of that, I think that we are in a situation that has been never achieved in the past. So I take this an example how to regulate the passage from this monopolar to the multipolar multipolar world. And we have the possibility to do it. And we have already, and I end with this, many indispensable fields of cooperation. Let us take, well, because it's my experience now, let us take Africa. Everybody now is interested to Africa, no? All the big powers, for very understandable reasons, you know. The growth of mankind, the improving of diet, the improving of income, they have a consequence of new need for food, raw materials, and energy. Where are they? Africa and Latin America, the two continents in which you have more possibility of growth of that. And it is clear that if we use the old system of taking Africa as a battlefield, will be a disaster for everybody. If we start, let's say, trying to have Africa as a field of cooperation, will be better off for Africa and will be better off for all of us. And remember that when I talked to you before on the different rate of growth in the world, I didn't mention Africa. But Africa is, because of this international need of raw materials, and Africa is waking up. Well, I cannot talk of an African spring, because spring is a nice season, you know, and Africa is so poor. But this year, Africa, as average, in spite of Egypt, in spite of Libya, will grow between 4 and 5%. So it's already 6 or 7 years that Africa is, except Sahel, the area very poor where growth is not still going on, but Africa is moving, you know. And so this is the great occasion for mankind to try to exercise a positive change from monopolar to multipolar world, you know, a cooperation vis-a-vis the new development that you have in Africa in this moment. This is clearly a very superficial picture of what is happening, you know, and please don't consider it as an academic perfect speech. It's not. It's just an introduction to the discussion that we have to do together to understand which are the political changes that we need to make in order to have a peaceful world, that are possible, that are clearly possible. Difficult, because as I repeat, but this is must be clear, the moment of change are difficult to tackle, but they are for all of us a great, great opportunity. Thank you.
Very thought-provoking speech. I would like to now open up the floor for a Q&A session. May I now please ask the audience to ask questions for Professor Prati?
Three questions and then answers. Three questions and then answers. Three questions. Let's go.
There will be two mics going around. For students, please identify your name before asking the question. Thank you.
I only ask to speak slow, loud, and clear.
Good afternoon, Mr. Prodi. Welcome you to in Thailand. I am Fernand from French citizen. I will go straight forward to my question, and to make it short, you have been in Bruxelles, been in charge of Italy. Every day when I open a newspaper, I heard the word market. Today, I heard in ship there is problem, market go up, go down, euro go up, go down. So I wonder who governs the world, politics or the finance? Because me, when I go out on the street, there's a red light, I stop, and when there's a green light, I go. That is one matter. Second matter, why politics don't take action to inequality, to poverty, and now we have a big discussion between all the president of Europe about should we do austerity or not austerity. At the end of the day, since 30 years, 40 years, I am very interested in politics. Now I tell you straightforward, I don't trust political people anymore because nothing changed and we are going straight to the wall. I don't talk about Asia, I talk about Europe. So that makes me a bit disappointed about politics who are in charge of Europe actually. Sorry, my English is not so good, but I hope you catch my point.
Okay. You want to answer now? Well, I answer because you did three questions, so I can answer. Look, I start from the second one. Why inequality and what to do? This is, look, this makes me thinking as an economist, but even more as a politician, you know, because inequality is linked to your first question, international market, in which you have the sovereignty is going out of the governments, you know, so you are really right when you put a question mark on the real strength of politicians, of the political life, because with the mobility of capital and the globalization without an authority, you know, now the sovereignty of the different state is decreasing day by day. I used to provocate my students or telling them that now there are only two sovereign states in the world, United States and China. The other countries are not sovereign states for the reason that, you know, any time that they take a decision, this has the consequence of capital flowing out or, let's say, giving out of any possibility of control, you know. And clearly, I cannot give you an answer that will say will satisfy your desire and your insatisfaction, for the reason that if we don't arrive to a moment in which we can handle a common system, we shall go on in this situation of the markets prevailing on the national policy. And, you know, part of this is the, from that we have an explanation, the most important explanation of the inequality that you mentioned before. The triumph of the financial aspect of the economy vis-a-vis the manufacturing aspect of the real economy and the possibility of moving country by country has made, has moved the income to a different type of people, financial banking, and so moving from one class to another class and increasing the division, you know. But there is another reason, in my opinion, even stronger for inequality, and is how the democratic system is based now, or in the last 30 years, after the revolution, that from some point of view was indispensable and necessary in order to increase competition and increase the let's say, the productivity of the world. But after the revolution brought by Reagan and Thatcher, you cannot anymore mention taxation. In any election, if you mention taxation, you lose the election. And we were moving, and you know, like or you don't like or you like it, taxation is the most important instrument for a redistribution of income. Of course, that nobody likes it, but this is the truth, you know. And if you decrease and you put flat taxation because of the financial mobility that evades, you know, that flows away from taxation, clearly you have an increasing difference between wealthy and poor. Combine it with the globalization in which competition is in manufacturing, but not in finance. And so you have these forces that will bring to inequality. And so you'd say, I don't trust politics because they have not done anything on against inequality. But they are powerless in real terms vis-a-vis inequality, you know. And look, nobody wants to lose elections, you know, and this is the tragedy. And so nobody tells the truth to the electorate. There are moments in which you have to say, look, there are moments in which you have to decrease taxation, but there are moments in which you have to increase taxation. And nobody dares to do that because, and then we don't tell the truth. And another problem that I was discussing with the students when we were at lunch a few moments ago, you know, if you want to improve equality, you have to work on one main instrument, that is education. You know, equality means a standard level of education for the entire people. And, you know, education is a long-term strategy. The results of education are after 10 years, 15 years, you know, long time. But because of the modern and contemporary democratic system, you know, the politicians, they are obliged to look only at the short term, to look only to the next elections. And so you have a terrible contradiction that when you are in politics, you understand that you must spend more on primary school, nursery, university, education, but then you have election next month, you know. And then this is the terrible contradiction of our democracy, a contradiction that is the problem even in Europe, you know. We have, when the crisis, the Greek crisis started, the problem was very, 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 very small, manageable. It was, you could fix it with 30 billion euros, let's say $40 billion for a country, for a big entity like Europe is not such a big problem. But you had elections in some of the leading countries, namely local election in Germany. And so the decision was postponed, and when the decision was taken, it was not 30 billion, but 300 billion, you know, in 4 months. And but this is how democracy works, you know, and this is a big challenge of our democratic system vis-a-vis the authoritarian system. I had so many discussions in China, for example, about that, you know. I remember a Chinese authority telling me, look, how can you handle your long-term problems in a democracy in which you have local elections, regional election, national election, European election, it was Europe, and that you have election every 3-4 months, you know, and you think only to new election. And this is real a problem. Even more, and not only in European in European cases, but even in United States, not only you have interim election, but when you have, let's say, even local or partial election, this, because of the opinion polls, they have a terrible national general consequence, you know. I always give the example when Ted Kennedy, the Senator Kennedy, died. You know, he was a Democratic, you know, and in that moment, the Democratic members of the Senate, they were 60 and only 40 the Republicans. And so the Democratic lost election after the death of, and, you know, in this case, what about is not important, but the opinion polls for the next election immediately changed, and all the decision-making process were changing, you know, and politicians, even the Democrats, were not even, let's say, in the mood of taking brave political decision because of the fear of losing the elections. And this are the explanation of the disparity that we have in the world. And so, because of that, look, it's not the moment to say I don't trust politics, because we need politics. We have to change it. We have to look clearly on the problem that we have in front of us and try to change them. Because it's not the over. Exceeding power of politics, our first problem is that politics is powerless for the real political problem that we have to solve, you know. And we have to put politics in the right position in order to take decision, you know. This is our challenge, not only European, but of all countries of the world, and the United States included.
Next question, please.
A lady. There was a lady. No. You are already started. No. Can you use the mic?
Okay. I just wanted to say I'm on the same side of the fence that you're on, ideologically, but I would like to know what you think, considering the greater good of the European community, the euro, has it been an asset or a liability? Sorry? Yeah, considering the greater good of the entire European Union, would you say the euro has been an asset or a liability?
I am not the right person to answer, because I was one of the greatest supporters of the euro, and I am still a supporter of the euro. Because I think that because of the explanation of what I, the thought I expressed before about globalization, I do think that the single European nation, they will disappear being alone. And to transform a nation, you need to work on the two pillars of the modern state, the army and the currency. And so to put together the army, Europe tried in the 50s, and it was impossible, but you know, will be necessary in the future. But for the currency, it was unavoidable to tackle the problem. And I do think that vis-a-vis the future of Europe, to be without a common currency will be a persistent weakness, leaving the different states to make diverging policies. Of course, this is the general problem. Of course, we did mistakes. You know, when you do something absolutely new in history, you do mistakes. And we knew, and I also wrote in many interviews, and I was also accused to be too tough on that. We knew that we needed to accompany the common currency with common decision in financial policy and taxation policy. And when I raised this problem to my colleague or to my counterpart, I do remember the long conversation with the, let's say, the most prominent politician in that time, the German Chancellor Helmut Kohl. Of course, I was naturally, as any economist, telling, look, but if the currency is not protected by common monetary, by common banking policy, fiscal policy, there will be a crisis. And I wrote the euro will be stronger only after a crisis, because it was clear that you needed common institution. The answer was a wise answer of a politician, you know, but wise. They say, look, it was so difficult to convince the Germans to abandon the Deutsche Mark and to make this passage, or could be told the same for the French or for the Dutch, that now we have done this and the consequent decision will follow. But what happened? The world changed because of immigration, because of globalization, because of nationalistic revival. You know, the solidarity that was in that moment ready to make the steps, stop it, you know. And then now we are in the difficult moment in which we have the crisis. But let us be clear. After the decision taken by the European Central Bank last summer, the euro will stay for the future, there will not be any collapse. Of course, the decision to be taken will be slow, must be discussed in many ways. They will bring another unforeseen and I think very worrying consequence, that Europe will be, we shall have two Europes in the sense, working together, being the same union, but one group of nations who will share the euro will work together much more than the euro group of nations that will not share the euro. So we shall have additional difficulties to manage this in the future, but there is no alternative. And don't think that even the Cyprus crisis or will dissolve the euro. The euro is a reality and will be the instrument for Europe to be present in the world. Not, of course, will be the European center again, but at least with Europe playing the role and giving even to Asia the example of cooperation that is necessary in the world of today.
Hi, Professor Prodi, my name is Mei Li. I know that you're involved in an organization that promotes peace, global peace. What are some of the activities that are engaged in promoting peace? Thank you.
Look, well, I'm not engaged in global peace, but just in a small piece of global peace. Let's say the task that I temporarily have, you know, is the Secretary General of the United Nations asked me, look, the Sahel is the poorest area of the world. Sahel is a definition that is not even understood by the experts. It's a strip of land going from Senegal, from the Atlantic Ocean, to Eritrea. You could think long 5,000 kilometers and 1,000 large. That is the poorest area of the area, and in which you have not any common project of development. Small, poor states with poor governance, no infrastructure, no economic links, and you cannot build a modern progress, a modern economy, if you don't have some sort of cooperation. And what I've been asking is to start this process of inter-country cooperation of the Sahel. And what I am doing, first of all, to try to connect the universities of the area in order that the development comes from, not from United Nations, New York, or Geneva, or World Bank, but with the contribution of the local universities. And then to try to link which are the priorities that are very simple, you know, because in this case are infrastructure, energy, decentralized energy, and the big revolution in this case to bring development must be the same type of revolution that Africa had with the portable telephones, you know, to have energy, solar or decentralized, because without energy you can't do anything. Education and health is not. And then to try to. But from the other side, and this is the most difficult aspect of it, to try to connect the financial resources that are necessary to that, you know, not easy because it's a moment of difficult crisis, but trying to put together all the big players, in all the players in the world, not only the big, exploiting what? The common fear about terrorism. And I told you how divided was the Western world before, but in the case of Sahel, of the sub-African area, and Mali now, the fear for the terrorism that is spreading in the area is common to Russia, to China, to United States, to United Kingdom, you know. And so my effort now is to try to, let's say, to tell them, look, there is a common interest. First of all, to have cooperation in Africa. Second, that, you know, we have a common enemy that, you know, if we don't, if we are not linked together, will prevail. And this is not easy. Why? Because we never had this type of cooperation, of active cooperation. And so I'm trying to develop a new idea, you know, not to have a fund that is managed by UN or, you know, but the priorities are settled by international body. But the responsibility of investing is on the donor. Let's say, put it this way, if the German choose to build a hospital, they do it, Germany does it, and put the German flag. If China wants to build a railroad, well, it will not put the money in a undefined fund, but will build the railroad. And then they put his flag, you know. and to create some sort of virtuous competition in aid and trying to put down bureaucracy that is not trusted, not by United States, not by China, not by anybody. You know, this is the effort that I am trying to do. Of course, I only started the job. This will go on for 30, 40 years. Well, you start the process and then who knows?
Next question, please.
Hello. Okay. Good afternoon. What do you think about the conflict between South Korea and North Korea? And not only South Korea and North Korea, about no. China and
conflict.
Conflict.
About China?
No, no. About North Korea and South Korea. And all, because there are so many conflict in this area, in Asia. Okay, like the conflict between South Korea and North Korea. And also the conflict between China and other countries like Vietnam, Japan, Philippines.
No, no, I look, of course, I don't want to be too naive on that. You know much more than I do. But I only see that there is a strange contradiction. You know, in Asia, for the island, you have increasing tensions, and you know about what? About what? Not certainly about islands, you know, but certainly is a general problem of power, because the problem of islands can be solved in one second. You know, it's a simple, very simple problem, and the island are not California or let's say. But the contradiction, what is that? In spite of that, the Asian economic clusters is going on very well, and trade in cross investments are better and better every year. And you know, the example of the interdependence is so simple. When you have an earthquake in Japan, the Chinese factory stops. Or when you have a flood in Thailand, the same. You know, and when you look at statistics, I see that this is an increasing reality, you know, a fantastic new economic world of cooperation. Not planned, but real cooperation. And as an economist, I mix it. And I think that this is able to balance the political tension, because we arrive to a moment in which it's clearly a common interest to have some sort of agreement. Of course, politics is also irrationality. You know, if you look at the first and the Second World War, it was the irrational side of it that prevailed, pure power. But there are new strengths that will push for an agreement. And, you know, I do think that because of the different characteristics of the country involved, you know, cost of labor, different skill in China, Japan, South Korea, the role of the different role of the multinational companies of Korea and the Chinese company, I do think that the feeling, the consciousness that there are strong common links is becoming, in spite of the political tension, is becoming stronger and stronger every day. And I do hope that the wisdom, not, let's say, at least to delay the fight, the tension, will bring to a really new reality of the world. As a European, clearly, I do understand that this will bring the center of the world far from Europe. I have the clear feeling in my mind, but I do think that this is a necessity for peace, and this is a necessity for Asia, and this is also possible because of the transformation of and the new interdependence of Asian economy. When you understand how companies, factories move from China to Vietnam, to here, to there, when you see, look, this is something that never happened in the world, you know. Let us hope that will help also peace.
Good afternoon, Professor Prodi. My name's Ari.
Can you speak loud, please? I am very, 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 very old.
It's okay. My name's Ardi. I'm a student from Faculty of Liberal Arts. And here's my question. The present European financial crisis was apparently allowed to happen by politicians. So how can peace exist in a global consistency of concept of corrupt politicians and bankers? And is politics and peace an oxymoron? Thank you. The last one. Is politics and peace an oxymoron?
You mean, the Europe, if I understood well, your question is concerning the interaction between politics and economics inside Europe and the tension and contradiction that are existing on that. Is it the question? Yeah. Well, let us pretend that this is the case. Now, look, I do think that, you know, we are in a moment in which we are obliged to write a new picture of the intra-European relations. I hinted, and I told you before, what we were thinking when the euro was done. Now we have the clear idea that we have to harmonize the European policies, and the effort must be in this direction, and will bring I think, as I hinted before, positive results, even if will also bring probably to a two-speed Europe. This is the future will be how to run this contradiction, because we have arrived now and to a final point, you know, or let's say, if you stay together, you must be deeply together. If you have a concept of European Union like more like a trade area, you can you also have the possibility of not sharing all the decision making process, and this is reflected by the recent internal political debate inside the United Kingdom. You know, when the British Prime Minister, with a very intelligent speech that was very well balanced, because he didn't tell, "I want the referendum immediately," and he didn't tell, "I shall not want the referendum whether to be inside Europe or not." He simply told, "We shall have the referendum after the elections." You know, in 2016, he told that Britain will take time to have a decision. But also, it was clear that they understood that Europe will go on and will be impossible to stop this process. So I am optimist that Europe will make the necessary steps. There are all the interests to do that, even from Germany, because now, from the political point of view, inside Germany, you have a debate in which it seems to prevail the idea that Germany alone could be better off and so on and so on. But when you talk with the German business community, they understand very well that if there should be a split between the German euro and the non-German euro, the rate of exchange of the two euro will be so damaging the German economy that Germany could not be the same. And so it's not only interest of the South European countries to be closer and closer. The best interest is a German interest. So this is the reason why I think that the common glue will prevail, except UK, that they have to decide politically what they want in their future. You know, my opinion is that in the end of the story, they will choose Europe, but they have not yet decided. You know, and in the meanwhile, Europe must go on, because we cannot wait. You know, the decision of any country, you know, is a necessity to overcome the crisis, and we can do it only together.
Next question, please.
My name is Alice Mdoe. I'm from Stanford International University, and my major is Communication Arts. I'd like to ask you a question. What is Italy's stance in the Arab Spring, and how do you think it will affect Italians' relations with the Arab world? And during your speech, you said there are two sovereign states. So does it make globalization a friendlier term of neo-imperialism? Thank you.
The Arab Spring. Well, in terms of Italy, certainly the Arab Spring has damaged a lot Italian economy. Italy is very active in the Mediterranean, and from this point of view, the problems of change and turmoil happen in the countries in which Italy is the first or the second trade and an investment. First in Libya, second in Egypt, second in Tunisia, second in Syria. So clearly, by chance, not certainly because of our responsibility, because we are a Mediterranean country and we are very active in trade and investment in all the area. But the problem is that nobody knows which will be the end of this process. It's still going on. And, you know, I was very recently in Egypt. I follow deeply Libya. And the game is not over, you know. The situation is still full of tension. It's an ever-ending revolution, you know. And this worries me a lot. This worries me a lot, you know, because in Egypt, that is the key of the area. Egypt is 80 million people, maybe 100 million people, you know. But not only the key in terms of population, but the place in which all the Islamic thought is elaborated, teachers, doctrine is going from Egypt to the other nations, you know, and this situation of, I repeat, not settled governance is very, very, very worrying. Unemployment is growing. Tourism. I went to Cairo, and to see Cairo without any tourist is something that is really, it keeps your mind, you know. I do hope that the Arab Spring can be really reinforced by a solution of the existing political problems, you know. I am not optimist to see it, to see the immediate solution. The complexity of the social structures of this country, makes the passage to democracy much more difficult than anybody, me included, thought and hoped. I was thinking of 1 year of turmoil, of tension, and then, you know, the recovery, but it's already 2 years, and I don't see any immediate recovery.
Buongiorno, I'm Alessandro Ursic, Italian journalist. I have a follow-up question on the issue of Europe and the current crisis. You expressed the belief that faced to the current crisis, Europe in the end will choose more integration. But at the same time, at the electors level, in the last couple of years, there has been a growing wave of Euroscepticism, both in northern countries and in southern countries, which are heavily in debt. So how do you see this contradiction between the need for more integration and the popular will for actually less integration? How do you see this contradiction play out in the future?
Good question, but I do think that the contradiction is solved by the electorate, because you are right, there are many populists because of the crisis. Also, there are a lot of malaise, a lot of unrest, but when you go to the point and you have to vote yes or no, as it happened in Holland or in Spain, you know, Spain for Catalonia and the central government, but in Holland, the anti-European parties were absolutely prevailing. But when you arrive to the real decision to say yes or no, we had a shift in the votes that nobody could have never imagined. And I am convinced, not because of dream, but because of knowing people, that of course, when you are teasing, you are teasing. But when you go to the program, let us go back to the past, the European, they will vote for yes. And populistic party, they have been in Europe for a long time. Haider in Austria, Le Pen in France, now you have even in Italy this change. But I repeat my experience that when you go to the point, people say, look, our future is in Europe, not outside Europe.
We will be taking one more question.
My name is Daniel, and I'm a student of Faculty of Business, International Business. My question is, you mentioned that inequality deters growth. So I think we can define inequality in different contexts. In the context of Thailand, you can see, maybe you know already, you've noticed already, in terms of job market, a lot of Thai people are very open to doing anything, laying and trying their hands on different stuff, unlike developed country like in UK or in America, where there's very high unemployment rate as a result of, maybe not fully as a result of, but just because there's a social system there where people, when they are not employed, they have benefits to maybe grants from the government or social grants where it allows them to live on something while they are unemployed. And that system, it's not here in Thailand yet. People don't depend on government to give them anything. They have to set out to do stuff by themselves. So my question is, do you think there's a future for social system in a country like Thailand in the future? Is there a system for that? Will that work as the economy continues to grow to become a world economy or a major world economy? Is there a future for social system in Thailand or in other Asian countries as well?
Well, it's not easy to answer to your question because I don't know. I have to be honest. I don't know Thailand as deep as I should know in order to answer well to your question. But, you know, and my definition of inequality was very simple, a definition for an economist. The Gini coefficient, you know, let's say the rate of injustice that you can score with some mathematical formula. And so each country has its own problems, you know, and so I should be, you know, I don't want to behave like somebody that thinks to be able to answer to any question. But really, there is some general aspect of inequality that worries me more. One, I have already told you, and is how you tackle with the government intervention and taxation and this problem. The other one that I think will be important for the future of Thailand, but I am prudent, you know, is the new technology. Because I think that we have listened many lies about the information technology. Is a revolution that is different from the others, at least in my personal opinion. I have not yet read sufficient explanation, but this information revolution is a revolution that is hitting the middle class more than others. It's not a revolution that, you know, in Europe all the secretaries disappeared. You know, with a computer and iPad, 90% of the secretaries disappeared, you know. Millions of jobs disappeared. In factories, they are not the lowest level workers who disappear, but the skilled, you know. And when in other revolutions, you had immediately after, you know, the first any technological revolution in the first stage makes jobs disappear, you know. You have, let's say, when the motor car went, the builders of old, let's say, horse cars, and then they, of course, disappear. But then, you know, you had not only car factories, but gas distributors, refineries, roads, and with the rate, with electricity, has been the same thing. In this revolution, you have a destruction of the middle class, and very few, in you know, not only secretary, but I asked to some of the biggest European bankers, how many will be the employees of the banks in the 2020? Half or more than half than now? Everybody answered me less than half. And then, let's say, tourism agencies, trade, you know, you have a revolution in which the problem of manpower becomes more and more serious. And this brings problem to any country that is not growing very, very, very fast. And even Thailand, I think that this problem of let's say, destroying in some way a lot of jobs in the middle class will be very, very important. In this case, mankind should need a new distribution of labor. We should need an authority telling, look, only 20 hours working per week in everywhere in the world, but you know that this is completely impossible. And so we shall go, the biggest problem, the biggest economic problem for the future is employment, you know. I end with what I have been impressed in more in the, a very simple joke in, it was in New York Herald Tribune, you know. There was a, let's say, a small cartoon with a father and a son, and the son asked to the father, "Daddy, how many workers are needed in a modern textile factory like you have here in Thailand?" And the father answered, "In a modern big textile factory, the need is one worker and one dog." Say, "One worker and another?" "Yes. The workers that only looks that everything works well, and the dogs that is careful that the worker does not go too close to the machines." And look, I am really exaggerating this, but the new technology, the new information technology, the new technological change, they are making the problem of employment the number one of the future problems of mankind. This is another reason why we should need some sort of world authority. But clearly, I am clearly dreaming now. I know that I am dreaming, but just to make us thinking which will be the real problems of the future.
Thank you.
See you again. Very good. In this one. September. Yes. Politics is always a challenge. This is always important. Present problem. Thank you.
From Algeria.